Hey everybody, I'm so excited to show you a walkthrough of my actual planner. So on Thursday this week, you guys got to see a look at my online writing journal in Notion. So now I'm going to show you my updated plotting planner, which is inside a Happy Planner. So I've done a few videos and a few versions of this in the past with a bigger Happy Planner, which is the 8.5 by 11. And that works great if you're looking for a Happy Planner that's going to be easy for you to print your own sheets and put them in your planner. The big Happy Planner is actually better for that because you can just print on 8.5 by 11 sheets. The classic size Happy Planner, you have to kind of fiddle with the sheet size. So you have to print everything at 82%. And if you want to see just a very slight sort of walkthrough of how I did that, you can find it in last week's vlog about how I switched to working on Vengeful Darkness. I'll link that for you down below. But for me, it's been worth it to try going into the classic size, which is a smaller, like 7 by 9.25 size, because this is just more portable. And I was finding, especially with Evie getting a little bit older, she's kind of grabbing on everything. I can't always work at my desk, so I need to be able to move around the house a little bit better. So you can also see she's already written on so many of my stickers, but such is life. I am just rolling with it. But I am using a deluxe cover from Happy Planner. These are like faux leather, and I'm not even sure they make these anymore, but sometimes you can still find them on Amazon or eBay. So this is just the black one, and it's basically just a cover for your Happy Planner. You slide it into the back and it can hold your stickers and things like that. But if you can't find a cover, then just the Happy Planner works just as well. But I have decorated the cover with some stickers from a few different sticker shops, so I will link those shops for you down below. But let's get into the actual planner setup. Okay, so when I open the planner over here, what I've done is I've used some dot stickers, color dot stickers from Hourglass Sticker Co. Now hers come in sheets that look more like this, and they're mostly like multicolor. They're this kind of rectangular or square sheet, but I have manipulated them inside my Cricut software so that I can make these bigger sheets, or I can make smaller sheets for my time tracker. So they don't come like this, but I liked the colors that she was using, so I'm using that. And basically I've created one sheet for each of my current kind of books that I'm gonna be working on over the next year or so. And you will notice a theme as I set this planner up that I really love to color code. It makes things so much more visually appealing, but it also helps me to see at a glance kind of what I'm doing and how things are set up. I also just have a 2021 calendar from Lauren Phelps Designs in here that I can easily glance at to say, okay, if it takes me 6 weeks, how many days, et cetera, et cetera. These stickers in here are from Procrastaplanner. If you've been following me for a while, you know that I love her, Procrastaplanner, et cetera. So I will link her shop for you down below as well. I also created this large note card that has my color coding key just with book 12's title sort of covered up so that I haven't revealed that title yet, but you can see the different color codes here. Then another part of my color coding madness are a couple of other sheets. So these are more for like these bigger sheets are for color coding which project I'm working on, but these smaller sheets and the stars are for my point of view color coding within my project. So my current book I'm working on is called Vengeful Darkness. It's book 11 of my Shadow Demon Saga, and there are 4 points of view. So to keep everything sorted in my plotting, I color code everything according to point of view. I got these little dot stickers on Amazon. They're pretty inexpensive, so I will link them for you down below. The star stickers came from the Target Dollar Spot around back to school time several years ago, and I got like 10 packs of them because they were only a dollar, so I just use them for my color coding. But I don't know if those are still available, but they're just generic stars, so they should be pretty easy to find. And then I just have a little Simply Gilded page flag here in case I need to mark any page flags. Now last time I showed you guys this planner, I had a bookish cover on here with some rainbow discs, but I got this look at the magic around you cover and stargazer planner for $5 at Michael's during their clearance sales for the 2021 planners, and it had the metallic purple discs. Well, my branding for my Sarah Cannon career, my branding for my author career is this color purple, so I had to switch it out. I love it. So this is the stargazer planner. And what you'll find inside the actual planner is a hybrid between the Happy Planner and my own plotting notes. So it starts out with this 2021-22 calendar, and then it has this sort of overview dashboard. And what I'm hoping to do here is once I start actually drafting this book, every day I'm gonna come in here and I'm gonna write my word count so that at the end of the year I can see kind of how consistent I was with my writing, and it'll just be that kind of overview of how I did for the year. Then I still have this January sheet in here, so I'm probably gonna like tape something over it so it doesn't say January, like cover this with washi tape. But I also added in some little inserts here and there that have some photos like of my kids and things that I wanna think about. Another thing that I've printed out and put into my Happy Planner plotting planner is my 2021 writing plan. Now this is a freebie, and actually all of the printables that I'm gonna show you today are freebies. If you sign up for my newsletter list, I have them all in my resource library for anybody to grab. But at the end of every year, I try to plan out my writing schedule for the following year. So that's what this is. But I had to reprint it because I switched projects. Again, I have a vlog last week about this, so if you're interested, there's more info there. But part of what I'm doing this upcoming week is sort of redoing my plan. Now, I try not to redo my plan too often because I just can get into a loop of replanning and replanning. So I'm just gonna do it this one last time, and then I'm going to move on with my life. But it basically has a calendar so you can take a realistic view at your time and then plan your writing accordingly. And then, you know, you're gonna fall off schedule, but you just kind of stick with it as best you can. Then I do still have this January tab here, but I am gonna put over it and put probably put Vengeful Darkness over the top of this, but I just need to print that out. So I have created these two things inside Canva. You Never Know Who's Watching from the Shadows, which is the tagline for this book, as well as a sort of dashboard for the book itself with the cover and a little banner here that says my word count goal. And I've created one of these for each of the books that I'm planning on working on. Now I have this covered because I haven't revealed that these covers yet, but you can see the word counts here. And that way, because it's like laminated and it's sticking out a little bit, it's a little bit easier to tab to when I go to look for it. On the back side of that, I have my color coding key for this book. So like I said, there are four points of view, and I will just warn you that as I'm flipping through this, you're going to see the names of the characters. I can't really hide them. So if you were planning to read my Shadow Demon Saga, just be aware that you're going to hear some character names that are point of view characters that might provide just very mild spoilers for what's to come in the series, because we are 11 books in. So I have the four main characters and all of their color codes. So I'm just going to pull this out so that you can see it a little better here. This is just on another one of those index cards, and it's taped on with washi tape. So Harper is my main character. Now she's the point of view character for the first six books in the series, but starting with book seven, we branch into these four points of view. Harper is purple, Leah or Lazalia is green, Jackson is blue, and Aridin is red. And I have basically gathered, this is like so extra, I know, but it really helps me organize my thoughts. So I have this really cute Hello Kitty pen case, and I keep these four colored super tips here in the front so that, like I said, I need to stay portable. I also have some Click Art markers here. My green one is gone astray, it looks like, but I have these in the same colors. I also have some skinny washi tape in each of the four colors. So actually this top part is the Crayola Super Tip and the bottom part is washi. And I know they're hard to tell apart on screen, but that's what that is. And we've got those star stickers as well as those little dot stickers. And I also have matching color-coded post-it notes. These are all four from the Marrakesh collection, so I will link those down below if you're interested in those four colors. But I love these colors and it works out perfectly. And what I did was I just went through my super tips and I found the colors that I felt most appropriately matched the color code that I want to use. While I am in the process of showing you this colors and things like that, I'll just show you real quick what I have in this little pen case here. So I have one of my favorite Kiki K pens filled with a Pilot Precise V5 RT because I like to have just a plain black pen. like I said, I have these click art markers. These are from Zebra and they are more fine point. So if I want to write something in fine point, I also have a Uni Style Fit multi pen that has all four of these colors as well as a black, so that if I am really trying to stay portable, I can just carry this one pen and I don't have to carry all these markers and I can still keep my color code. So this is really helping me to stay flexible. With this, you buy the pen body and then you buy the refill, so you can choose the colors you want to go inside. And this particular one holds five colors and I got it from JetPen, so I will link that below. I also have some note cards here. So I will keep these note cards. I still haven't filled these out because I'm in the process of plotting. But once this plot is done, I will use these note cards. I will put a similar type of clip to this, so these little bookbinder clips that open up in the corner. So I'll create a little plotting booklet like this. And what I do is I just take a single hole punch and then loop them in. That way, again, portable, and I don't have to worry about my baby pulling them apart or anything like that because they will always stay in this configuration. So those will go in here eventually. I also have this little, it's called Into One, and it is a little binder. So these are little binder clips the same way. They open just like your like old school three ring binders. And I have moved my little plotting notes from, I have always used these note cards with plotting notes like my plot points and things like that, but I'm moving it into this because I feel like this will be more durable than like Evie pulling on things, and these tend to get kind of torn and stuff like that. So you can see I've taken all of those same notes and I've moved them into this notebook. So I have like the hook and everything that happens there, the dramatic question, the key event, the argument against transformation, and then I have each of the acts separated by one of these little tabs, as well as one of these little like kind of section headers. So this will become my new plotting notes, and I'm hoping I won't have to like recreate this, whereas these note cards I've had to create four or five times because they tend to get messed up. So that will all live inside this little plotting pencil case. So that is my color code. Next, I have my writing plan. And again, all of this next section is printables that I created myself. And if you are interested in using them, I'm going to walk you through how to use them. But if you want them for yourself for free, just go sign up for my newsletter. I'll have a link for you down below and I will send you a link to the entire resource library. And you can just go and download everything for free and use it as you want. And you can reprint this every time. So the first thing is a writing plan. Now I do have a video of how to fill this out, so I will link that down below, but it's basically a way that you can say, I have all these phases, like when I'm going to start the book, when I'm going to finish the plotting, when I'm going to write the rough draft, when I'm going to send it to betas, and all of this. And then you have a goal of when you want to do that, like kind of like your milestone or your deadlines. And then you have a section to put when it actually happened. And part of why I find this useful is because I tend to always overestimate how fast I can write a rough draft or how fast I can get my edits done. So this lets me gather data where I can say, well, I expected to start my edits on April 25th, but I actually started them on, you know, May 1st, which hopefully that's not actually going to happen because the book is coming out on May 11th. So this gives me a chance to see how I'm doing versus like my goal versus my actual. And then down here at the bottom, there's a little section for review that you fill out when your book is finished that you can say, what was that final word count compared to the goal? And how long did it take me? How many days did it take me? And then a little bit of journaling about how did you feel while you were writing it and what would you change about the next book. The next little section is so cool. So this is basically a word count tracker. And again, you have this, if you've purchased my HB90 planner, you have this in the back of the planner, but it's also in my free writing resources. I love to write in sprints, like Pomodoro technique. So what I like to do when I'm filling this out is there's a section for the date, the sprint, what I've written so far for the whole day, and then what I've written so far for the whole book. And what I have done here is I have given myself an estimate of how many sprints I think it will take me to finish this book. So it's a 100,000 word book, and I'm estimating at least 650 words every time I write a sprint on average. Some of them will be 300, some will be 1,000, but I'm guesstimating for every 25 minute sprint, which is my preferred time, I'm gonna write about 650 words. So because of that, it's gonna take me, I'm guessing, about 140 to 160 sprints to write this book. So what I have done is I have taken these pages and I've printed them several times back and front. And I have numbered the sprints. So each label or each column is 25 sprints. So you can fit 50 per page. So I've labeled them all the way out to 160. It's possible the book will be done somewhere on this last sheet, but I wanted to give myself plenty of space just in case I have some bad sprints. Then what I've done is at the bottom of each column, I have marked about how many words I think I should have by the time I get to the sprint at the bottom of the column. So 25 sprints in, I should be about 16,250 words into the book. By the time I finish 50 sprints, I should be at least 32,500. And what I'm hoping, and the reason I'm doing this, is because I'm hoping that this, like, a lot of times when I break things down into manageable chunks, the same way I do with my tasks with the HB90 system, when I break it down into something I can see and measure, it motivates me, because instead of feeling like, oh my God, I've got to write 100,000 words, I can sit down and I can say, ooh, if I get five more, I'm going to be this much closer to 1650. And that is just going to feel better. And then what if I get to the bottom and I've already written 18,000 words? Wow, I'm ahead, and that's going to feel really good. It's also going to be one of those things of like, if I get several days in and this still says March 1st and I haven't continued writing, I'm going to start to feel that anxiety of I really need to add things to my sprint sheet. Another thing that's going to be fun that I'm going to try for the first time is that I'm going to share this word count tracker sheet with my fans every Friday on my Sarah Cannon YouTube channel. We do a live coffee chat Q&A every Friday, and I'm going to share this with them. So if you want to come join us, I will leave a link to that YouTube channel. It's at 4 p.m. every Friday, and we have so much fun in that little community. And I'm going to actually show them a photo of how these sprints are going. And that is going to help motivate me, because I'm really looking for ways to hold myself accountable and continue to write. And I think that estimating the number of sprints and kind of knowing that there is a limit, like eventually I'm going to finish this book. If you want to know more about how to actually like guesstimate or estimate how many words you write per sprint, I do have a 5-day writing sprint challenge. That is also a workbook that's linked in that resource library. And I did a bunch of lives here on YouTube last month, if you're interested in seeing a little bit more about how that process works and finding your sprinting sweet spot. So by the time I get to the end of this, the book should be done. The next little thing I have is a writing tracker. Now this is similar, but this specifically tracks every sprint that I do. This one tracks each day of work. So I have, basically I started the book on February 23rd, and I have every single day leading up to my deadline. I'm publishing the book, it's on pre-order for May 11th. And then I actually have the following week as well, because I know there's gonna be like publishing and promotion type things that are going on. So I've printed out enough sheets of this to put in a time for every single day. And then what I've done is each day that I've started working on it, I've been able to say, prep phase, what did I get done? I haven't really used the note section as much right now, but I use that more in my drafting, that I'll be able to say notes, oh, I wrote a scene about Harper, or oh, tomorrow I want to write this scene about Jackson, or whatever. So I've got the prep phase, the plot phase, and so on. Obviously drafting is going to be the next phase, and I can mark what I did. And what I've got here is already a day that says I didn't get anything done. And I really don't want a lot of days like that. And I might actually go in and put a star on this or highlight it so that it will be that level of like, I don't want to have to highlight another day. I need to get some work done, even if it's 30 minutes. So I will fill this out throughout the writing of this book. Then at the very end of this workbook that is in my writing library, resource library, I have listed out all of these writing phases that I have. So you can fill in your own depending on your own process. So I have a prep phase, which is basically printing out everything, getting the note cards ready, choosing my color code, all that stuff, setting up my plotting wall. Then I have the plotting phase, which usually takes me a long time to do. Then I have the rough draft phase. I have the second draft phase where I go through it again. I have self-edits, which is kind of my third draft. Then I have my beta readers. I have my professional editor. I have my final edits, which includes my like inputting of what my editor had to say, plus a final proofread. At that phase, also with the final edits, I also do a run through naturalreaders.com where I listen to my book read to me so I can catch any other typos or inconsistencies or things that don't flow. Then there's a formatting phase and a publishing phase. So I've got all of those phases for myself. I have a goal of when I want to start those phases, and then I have a list of the actual start dates, right? So plotting, I already started a day late and I haven't quite finished, so that will go here when it gets done. This also is another way for me to see how well I estimated how long something would take, so that next time I want to put a book on pre-order, I have a better idea of how long it takes me to do any given part of the process. Over on the second part of the spread, I have a target word count. This is mostly going to be for the drafting phase. A target word count, an actual word count. How many hours did it take me to complete all of these sections, as well as any notes that I want to leave? So that's it for the like data collection. If you watched my video on Notion, you'll know that a lot of this I'm also going to be tracking in Notion. And basically, I'm going to use this book as a guinea pig. What was I more consistent keeping up with? What data did I enjoy keeping up with most? And which one do I want to use moving forward? Because I like the digital for the fact that I can keep it for many years to come. Like, how fun would it be to go back and see this data for the very first book I wrote versus the 20th book I wrote? But there's something magical for me about putting pen to paper. So I don't know. We'll see. It'll be a battle of digital versus analog, or it'll be a combination of both, and we'll see at the end. The next thing I have in this plotting planner is my Plot Your Novel workbook. So again, a freebie in my library that you can grab. I have printed it out for all four points of view. So remember, I've got those four colors, the four points of view. I also have the four colors marked here with washi tape. So this is just a single piece of washi tape folded over the top to kind of create a tab. And I can tell, like, okay, Leah's section starts here because it's green, just for easy reference for myself. So I have printed out each of these sheets in 82% scale. Remember, I like to cut my page down already to 7 by 9.3 or 9.29, and then I print at 82% scale to get this effect of in the small happy planner. But like I said, if you don't want to fiddle with printing sizes, get a big happy planner, because that's like normal letter size. So these sheets, I won't go through them too much because there's an entire playlist on YouTube about how I fill these out and how I plot my novels. So if you want to check that out, I will link that down below for you as well. But basically, this is the character sheet, is the first full sheet where I go through their goal, motivation, and conflict, their beginning, middle, and end of their character arc, as well as anything that I need to know about them as a character. Then the next few sheets are my plot points. So I have Act 1, the first half, and the second half of Act 2, and Act 3. Sometimes I will do like I did on these earlier sheets, and I will put some of the skinny washi tape down here. This time I was just trying to go faster, and I just used the Crayola Super Tip and put a line at the bottom. And the reason I do this with the color code is because when I look at this, it just signals to my brain I'm in Harper's POV, because when you're writing multiple points of view, especially like more than two, it starts to get really confusing whose head you're in at any given time. So this really helps me say, okay, it's Harper because it's purple. And so I just like doing that. So I will fill all of this stuff out for each of the four characters. So I have Jackson's is blue, Leah again is in the green, and Arden is in red. And so I will fill out all of this. Now, when I'm actually writing my book and plotting the book, you won't necessarily see like the argument against transformation plot point on screen or on the page for each of the four characters. I have talked a bit about how to write series on this channel. I have a whole series of videos on that, but if you guys want to see a series of videos on how to write multiple POV, because I have several series that have more than four points of view, if you would like to hear more about how I manage and balance those points of view, let me know. Make sure that you like this video, subscribe, and comment down below, and I can work on some videos regarding that. But basically, I fill out as much as I can about each of the four characters, even if that scene is not going to be something that you see in the book. It's something that happens kind of off screen, so to speak, or off stage. It still is something I want to know about that character and what they've experienced, as if they're going through real life. So I do fill all of that out. Then I have a section at the end of the plotting notebook to list their scenes. So this is like plot points, But tests and challenges, like that's not all the scenes. That's just like the major plot points. There's more that needs to be filled in. So I will often use this for scenes list. And then the final page is that story grid. So this is kind of my story structure. You've got the first half, you've got the first act, first half of act two, and the midpoint will take place here. But I always know that my main story points happen at the end or the bottom of these columns. I have one of these printed for each of my characters, especially in this book, book 11. A lot of the characters are going to be separated. Jackson and Arden are together for a lot of this book in the beginning, but Harper's on her own. Leah's on her own, and they're going through their own thing. So I will fill this out as much as I can for each character. So I have all of those sheets done. Then when I get to the end, which is Arden's point of view, I have taped these pages together. And this is where I have taken some of the actual Happy Planner pages and I have rearranged them. Now I do have some videos on this as well from that I used from that earlier bigger Happy Planner. But Happy Planner sheets tend to have, let me see if I can pull one up here. This is what it looks like before I got my hands on it. The date at the top, and then it has three boxes that go from top to bottom. So what I've done to create basically my own story grid is I have covered up the dates. I've written my color code out to the side and my goal. And then I have whited out the different like blocks because I don't actually want three separate sections. I just want two sections for each part. So I tend to go act one is both of these first two sections. The first half of act two is here, the second half of act two is here, and all of act three ends up here. The reason that I do that for myself, like if you want to have two for act three, you could like make this first section another section. But act three for me usually has less scenes because the scenes get really long as we're like approaching the final battle or the final conflict and resolution. So this is usually the shortest act for me and I don't usually have to keep up with the plotting as much at this end. So I try to get as detailed as possible in the front. Now I haven't marked these yet, but what I will do is I will add like a little sticker here that says act one, part one, act two, or act one, part two. Or what I usually do is just a big thing here that says act one, first half of act two, first half of act three, and so on. Again, I will link all these videos that I'm referencing so that you can binge watch Heart Breathing's videos for the next couple days if you have not seen those. I can also give you guys an update if you're interested of what this looks like in the end. It's just hard for me to do that sometimes because then people that decide they want to read my books are going to get spoilers. And this particular series, when I'm in book 11, I've been writing this series for a decade. I really don't want spoilers on the internet because the twists are the best part. And I try to make sure that I surprise my readers. So I gotta have it twisting. So I will fill this out. And again, I will use these tiny little dots that I showed you from Amazon, these little ones here, so that if it's Harper's scene, I will put the little purple dot and I will write what's happening to her. Sometimes I use small page flags for this part because I can move them around. So I might use that, but once the plot is a little bit more solidified, I'll start using these dots. Then I just have basically some blank paper. So this is just for brainstorming. And what I like about using a Happy Planner is that I can add and take away sheets. So if I want to brainstorm more, I can add more sheets. I also have a few more little inspirational photos here for myself. Then I have the March calendar. Now, if you watched my Notion video, you'll kind of, this will look familiar to you because what I hope to do is take, remember how I have these little plotting dots? Where did the other one go? So here's the one for Vengeful Darkness. So what I intend to do is be able to use this monthly at a glance to see how many words I wrote per day or how many sprints I did. So I have a friend, Ines Johnson, I mentioned her in the previous video, that she takes her monthly spread in her bullet journal or in her planner and she puts stars, like gold stars, and she puts one star for every 500 words she writes. I wanna keep track of my sprints. So instead of tracking how many words I wrote, I wanna keep track of how much time I spent. So for example, on Wednesday, I spent 3 sprints working on this book. So I would put 3 dots here so that I will be able to look back at this overall spread later and be able to see how much work did I really put into this book. And that's going to help me, again, get an at-a-glance view of how I was doing and how much time I spent and where, like, oh my gosh, I never got anything done on Saturdays. I should just probably take that day off and stop giving myself a hard time about it. But it helps you to identify patterns like, wow, I always write more on Thursdays than any other day. It just gives you that at-a-glance view. Now, for now, I do still have the regular Happy Planner weekly sheets. I don't know if I'm going to use these. What I was thinking is I could use these for like social media and promotion to plan out like countdowns or teasers or when I'm going to do my cover reveal or any like posts that I'm going to make on Instagram relating to the book or flat lays or anything like that. But I have to say, right now my life is so busy. I don't really feel like my social media game is on point. It's really just kind of like, I think I'm going to post a picture of this today. And I don't do a lot of planning for my social media because I just simply don't have time. So I may use this. I may take these sheets out and just use them for plotting stuff later. But for now, they're in here. Then all that's in here is you've got the rest of the months. And then I have things set up for the next book. And again, I haven't printed out those little plotting sheets yet because I'm not ready to work on the book, but I will print them out later. But I have kind of all the rest of the projects that I plan to work on for the year are in here. And I did have, like I mentioned about social media, I bought these social media planning packs a while back on clearance at Michael's, like 6 months ago or a year ago. And so I could use this instead of those weekly sheets. Like I was saying, if I wanted to start planning my social media in the month of March, what I could do is instead of using these weekly sheets, I could use these social media inserts because it gives you a chance to put four different accounts. So I could say, here's what I'm doing on Facebook page. Here's what I'm doing in my group, on my Discord server, and on my YouTube channel, or Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, Discord. And I could say what I'm posting every day. And then I can see it at a glance. And it's a little bit more organized than just an open sheet. So just so you're aware, they do have these social media sheets. And on the back, it has kind of the same four spots. And then you have some checklists like reading, reply to comments, create a post, check your links, check your spelling, schedule the post. So those are kind of cool. So I might use those as well. But the meat of the plotting planner is really this, as well as all of these printed plotting pages. So like I said, it's a lot of printables, but all of these are free if you want to check them out. And that is basically everything in my new plotting planner. Let me know in the comments what you think of this. And if you watched my Notion video, what do you think you would like using better? Happy Planner or Notion? What works best for you? Also, I am posting this video on Saturday because I wanted to make sure that everybody knows my HB90 Bootcamp course does close tonight at midnight. So if you're watching this when it first comes out, Saturday, March 13th, midnight EST, so Eastern Time, New York City time, the doors close to this spring round of the HB90 Bootcamp. If you wonder how I get as much done as I do and still keep a good attitude and still take care of my mental health, it's because of this system, and it can truly be life-changing in helping you reach your writing goals. I would love for you to join us. If you're not quite ready for the course, but you want to try the planner, the Q2 HB90 Method Planner is 20% off just for today and tomorrow, I think, and then it's back to full price. There's also a goals planner that doesn't have the daily planner in it. It just has all the goal setting pages for the whole year. So go check those out. It's all on sale over on my Etsy page if you want to check that out and you want to kind of get used to the system before you jump into the course. Other than that, the course will not reopen again until June. So jump in while you can. I would love to see you there. We have a kickoff call tomorrow night or Sunday night. That is always fun, and it's such a great community of writers. So come join us. And that's it, you guys. Let me know what you thought of this plotting planner, and happy writing. Make sure you're subscribed, and I will see you in my next video. Bye.